After 2 weeks on the ship, it felt like all of the icebergs had developed their own personalities. Lars was the giant, Archie fell apart every time we tried to measure it, and Stingray was elusive, so every time we found it again, it was like reconnecting with an old friend.
Welcome to Wavelengths, where we talk about our planet with experts from Scripps Institution of Oceanography, covering everything from the deep sea to the edge of the atmosphere. I'm Kate Furby, a marine biologist and journalist. I got my PhD here a few years ago, and now I'm back, learning more about what's happening at Scripps. I'm here today with Margaret Lindeman. She's a fourth-year graduate student here at Scripps Oceanography. And you study icebergs, is that right?
Yeah, I study ice-ocean interactions, so the way that glaciers flow into the ocean and how they melt. Welcome to the iceberg repository, an all-around cold place.
I feel like we're really going somewhere. Oh, it's like Narnia. This is like the Narnia closet.
So welcome to the freezer.
This is awesome. It's cold.
Yeah, this is where the paleoclimate people keep their ice cores. And
wow.
This is a real ice core from Greenland.
Cool.
So this is tens of thousands of years old, and it formed when snowflakes fell over many, many years and compacted together.
Wow, so it's like fossil snowflakes.
It's just like fossil snowflakes. Amazing. And so when they compacted together, it trapped air in these little bubbles, and that's what you see when you look closely.
Oh, wow, yeah, you can totally see the bubbles. Each little bubble has the atmosphere from tens of thousands of years ago.
Yes. Every single one.
So in Greenland, the snow accumulates over many years and compacts to form ice. And then it gets so thick, it flows under its own weight. And when it reaches the ocean, it breaks off in a process called calving, which is how the icebergs form.
So then, like, how big are we talking? Like,
so when they break off, they can be really huge. And there's some that we saw that were the size of 7 football fields, just really massive.
Wow.
So are you ready to watch some ice melt?
Yes.
Great. So here we have our super fancy aquarium tank, and we're going to use this to look at the different types of water that there are in the ocean in Greenland. And so mine are relatively fresh, and yours are warm and salty. Warm and salty.
So cool. Let's pour them into the tank at the same time.
Okay, so when we pull out the divider, we should see the less dense water go on top of the more dense water. So here it is. It's an iceberg.
Looks like a popsicle. Cool. This one's blue raspberry.
They're all blue raspberry flavored. I'm just gonna put that in our ocean here. And so for a lot of these icebergs, they can be as deep as the Empire State Building is tall. And so it really matters how they're affected by these different layers of the water.
So the iceberg is melting underwater, and you're studying where that meltwater is going.
Right.
Cool. So like, why is that important?
Well, the oceans really control the climate in some very important ways. And for example, the Gulf Stream brings warm water from near the equator up towards Northern Europe. And so that's, for example, why Italy is usually a lot warmer than Maine. And so adding a lot of fresh water to the ocean is going to change how those currents are able to move heat around in the ocean. And where the fresh water is, what depth it's at, is going to play a really big role in what that looks like.
So actually the way icebergs are melting could be critically important for the global climate.
Yeah, and climate change and sea level rise are already happening. So really understanding what we're observing now can help us be better prepared for the future. It's amazing to get to do research in a place that feels so different from everywhere that I know, but know that the research has really big implications also for the places that I have called home.